Well, happy Sunday, everybody, and happy Mother's Day to all of you who have played a motherly role in some way in someone's life, to all of us who have been impacted by mothers or a woman who has had a motherly impact on us. Happy Mother's Day to all. A few announcements before we do get started. You'll see on the back of the bulletin is announcements about the life of our church. A couple things. First, I will be at a conference for continuing education tomorrow through Thursday. So if you have any needs, please do contact. You can contact me directly and I'll get back to you when I can. Or if you let Lenny know, she'll get in contact with me as well. So if you would do that, that would be wonderful. Next Sunday is a Sunday of different things for us. First off, at 9 a.m. in the parlor, we will have we will continue our discussion of a celebration gift, 150th anniversary celebration gift for the church and also the community. So if you'd like to come and join us for that, there will be treats and drinks and stuff, and then we will talk about that as well. And then at 10:30, we will be celebrating with our brothers and sisters at Christ Episcopal, the Reverend Marilyn Haseman, sorry if I mispronounced that, will be preaching next Sunday for us as we worship together with them. They're coming over here. And so if you would like to join us next week, we will have an ecumenical worship service that will include communion as well. So we will share the Lord's Supper with our brothers and sisters of Christ Episcopal as well. And then you can see what else is going on, and I believe Doris has an announcement for us.
Good morning. This month's 150th reflection is on education. Presbyterians put an emphasis on equal education for all people. Because of this, they planted and encouraged schools across the U.S. as the country grew and the missionaries were sent out to the people. In times past, when Presbyterians arrived in a new place, they would usually build a church, a school, and a hospital in that order. Presbyterians see the right to worship God as paramount, and education is necessary so they can serve the world in God's name. Two members of this congregation, Francie Reed and Idella Whitmer, thought education was so important, they left money so future students could continue their education after high school. Each year, the Beatrice Educational Foundation awards two scholarships to students from Reed's bequest. One is given on merit and one is based on financial need. Idella Whitmer was a lifetime member of this congregation. She was born on August 23, 1892. She was a career woman and was active in the YWCA activities and the Wesleyan Society. She was also active in business and professional women. During World War II, she helped by knitting sweaters for servicemen. The Beatrice Daily Sun did an article in the newspaper about the thank you she received from one of the servicemen. I really appreciate the sweater now especially. There is lots of snow. It's ever cold. We sleep in all our clothes. Oh, to be in Florida. Sincerely, H.R. Ross. She also completed the Red Cross Nurse Aid Program during this same time. She was also active in the church. In 1917, she gave a program on what is the value of discipline during Sunday school. She married John Whitmer on May 14, 1950. She died on December 6, 1968. Her memorials and estate were left to this church. I give and bequeath my estate to the Presbyterian Church of Beatrice, Nebraska, to be used by the trustees of said church at their sole discretion. I could not discover why the trustees chose to establish the Idella Whitmer Scholarship specifically for young people that have grown up in First Presbyterian Church Beatrice. One person thought it was the idea of longtime member George Kilpatrick. But what I did discover with the help of Lenny was that from 1970 until today, more than 200 students have been helped because of her generosity. The first scholarships were awarded to five students in 1970. Currently, the scholarship is worth $500 a semester or $4,000 over eight semesters. This weekend, as area schools hold their graduation ceremonies, let us remember the enduring legacy of both Francie Reed and Idella Whitmer and the impact it has had on our children.
Are there any other announcements that I may have missed? All right. You can see our prayer list on the back of the bulletin. Are there any other joys, concerns, or cares to be that we can lift up with the community together in prayer? Mason. Okay. Thank you. Yeah, Mason's dad was in a motorcycle accident this week. Excuse me. And he's had a couple surgeries, but have come through that well. And so we just pray for healing and that he will be able to recover from that. So thank you, Mason, for lifting that up. Any other prayers, joys, concerns? All right. Well, let's prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. Then invite you to sit comfortably. And to take a deep breath in and breathe out. Breathe in God's love. Breathe out God's love to others. Breathe in God's love. And breathe out God's love to others. Gracious God, on this Sunday that we come celebrating the women, the mothers in our lives, celebrating all those who have been parent figures for us, we come to you, our parent, our shepherd, our Lord, and our God, the one who created us, the one who watches over us, the one who journeys with us. Lord, we come because we know that you are always present with us. And so to set the tone for the rest of our lives, we come to make ourselves intentionally present with you now. So let our hearts and our minds and our ears, our souls be open to your presence with us now through the Holy Spirit. Help us to hear your words of hope, your words of grace, your hope, your words of challenge, your words of promise. As you call to us, Lord, each of us by name, help us to respond in our time together here and in our everyday lives. Gracious God, in your name we pray. Amen.
As the sheep of Jesus, we gather together to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus and his presence with us in our lives. Let us follow the example of our shepherd and give everything we are to God as we join in our call to worship. As a shepherd calls to their sheep, as a shepherd cares for the lambs, looking out for the lost and the least, as a shepherd rejoices when the lost sheep are found, as the shepherd leads the sheep to safety and rest, we follow our shepherd's voice into this time of worship, finding safe rest in our God. In anticipation of experiencing the risen Jesus with us today, let us proclaim the good news of God's faithfulness and sing, "Great is thy faithfulness." You are invited to stand if you are able and move how the Spirit moves you.
Thank you.
Everyone needs compassion, the love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. Our God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. Souls still thirst. God leads me in right paths for His name's sake. O Lord, we long to be led by You, though we may complain along the path. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. And yet, O God, we do sometimes fear. May we feel Your presence, Your comfort, and Your forgiveness anew. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. O God, sometimes we refuse to sit down at Your table. Forgive us and help us to see Your overflowing mercy. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Forgive us, God, and lead us into Your house as we offer our personal confessions to You. And let's confess silently to God. And amen. The psalmist writes, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." Friends, believe and proclaim the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. You are invited to be seated. And children are always welcome in our worship service, but at this time we take an intentional moment to be with them and to speak with them and to gather them together up front. So will you please come forward if you desire to for our time focused with children.
Look what I've got with me today. Two friends. I do. Some lambs, exactly. They have both been on quite the journey, okay? This one may be a little bit harder journey than this one, okay? But they were all loved. Both of them were loved very, very much by the people that they belonged to. Now, the people that they belonged to were kind of like shepherds. What do shepherds do for their sheep? What do they do, Mason? Yeah, they do. Lindley, what else do shepherds do? Do you have a thought? They do, so they have to make sure that they get to the grass, don't they? So that they can eat grass. Anything else? What do you think, Daniel? Sure, okay. So what if one of them gets sick? Okay, yeah. Or what if they hurt a leg or something? Yes, they would help treat it. Okay, what if they get lost?
They'll find them.
Yeah, they go out and find them. Okay. This one actually did get lost and was lost for a couple of days. And I tell you, the person that owned this searched and searched and searched. Okay, and finally it was found. Okay. Now this one, okay, its shepherd loved it so much, and it loved somebody else so much that it actually gave this sheep, he gave his sheep to somebody else. Okay, and that reminds us of what Jesus, of what God did for his son. He gave his son for us. He did. But these sheep, like I said, they have been on a journey. A long journey, okay? But their owners took care of them. They led them. They fed them. They protected them. And that's just what our God does for us. Jesus does that for us each and every day. But we have to listen to him. Because if the sheep didn't listen to their shepherd or their owners, okay, they would get lost too, right? So we have to listen to what Jesus tells us to do. But he is always our shepherd, leading and guiding us every single day. All right, let's pray. Jesus, help us to listen to your voice so that we can journey through life with you as our guide. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
This morning, we hear the word of our Lord in the Gospel of John, chapter 10, verses 22 through 30. Let's listen for God's good news to us today. At that time, the festival of the dedication took place in Jerusalem, It was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple in the portico of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I have told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name testify to me, but you do not believe, because you do not belong to my sheep. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. What my Father has given me is greater than all else, and no one can snatch it out of the Father's hand. The Father and I are one." This is God's word of hope for God's people. Let us give thanks to God.
And let us hear God's word from the psalmist in the 23rd Psalm. It is a familiar psalm to many of us, but let us listen with new ears for the message God has for us today. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me down right paths for his namesake. Though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall live in the house of the Lord my whole life long. This is God's word to us, God's people, God's sheep. And so we say thank you, God. You can't seem to watch TV. You can't seem to go around town. You can't seem to be on any social media website. You can't seem to even live anymore without hearing about the phenomenon that has been happened over the last couple weeks, the phenomenon of the Avengers Endgame. It opened just over 2 weeks ago, and it has already earned more than $2.25 billion worldwide. That is billion with a B. And it's still in movie theaters, and there's still possibilities of seeing it 24/7 if you really want to in some theaters. But it's not only the Avengers movie that has been popular. The Avengers movie is where, as you see, tons of these superheroes come together to fight a common enemy. But it's not only the Avengers movie, this most recent one, that is popular. Of the top 10 most grossing, the movies that have made the most money in history, over half of them are superhero movies. We tend to like, in the world, and especially in the United States, this idea of a superhero. We like the superhero story. In his book, and a book written by David Lamotte, who is an author and a peace fighter, that's kind of oxymoronic, isn't it? Peace fighter, a peace worker, a worker for peace. He calls this story of superheroes the hero narrative, and here's how he describes it. In this narrative, large-scale change happens when an extraordinary individual takes dramatic action in a moment of crisis. Then the problem is fixed, the threat is removed, and the credits roll. We love that storyline, as evidenced by the fact that it provides the plot for most of our entertainment, and arguably, our history books as well. You could also argue that it's evidenced by the money that's spent and earned by superhero movies, and just how pervasive a superhero movie becomes in the midst of our society. We could also argue sometimes that the pervasiveness, the popularity of this superhero narrative is seen in our very faith lives as well. Sometimes we like to believe or desire for God to be a superhero for us. We desire God to come and to save us from the struggles that we're having, for Jesus Christ to come and lift us up out of that valley and to take us to a place where we can have peace and rest. We desire for God to swoop in and to maybe even turn back time so we don't have to go through the suffering that we went through before. It seems nice. It would fit that superhero narrative. But the thing with that is that there are some issues. Superheroes tend to swoop, to save, and to leave. Superheroes come in the midst of a struggle, in the midst of danger. They save the person, and then they go off, and they go because there's other people to save. Sometimes superheroes have a very small group of family or friends that they seem to constantly be saving over and over and over again. But otherwise, the superhero comes, they do their superhero act, and they leave. And the issue is that this is not who God is. God does not come and save and leave. Our God is not a hero. Our God is our shepherd. A hero swoops, saves, and leaves. A shepherd journeys with us. A shepherd goes with the sheep into the dark valleys, into the hard times, so that they know they're not alone. Not saving them from the struggle, but going with them through the struggle. And going along with them even once they've come out. Presbyterian pastor and theologian and writer Frederick Buechner talks about how this looks. How does it look for God to not be a superhero, but for God to be a shepherd in the midst of our lives, as he writes in his book Beyond Words about experience he had following September 11th. He writes, "On the evening of the day the World Trade Center was destroyed by terrorists, a service was hastily improvised in one of the largest New York churches, where crowds of both believers and non-believers came together in search of whatever it is people search for at such times. Some word of reassurance, some glimmer of hope. At times like these, the speaker said, God is useless. When I first heard of it, it struck me as appalling. And then it struck me as very brave. And finally, it struck me as true. When horrors happen, we can't use God to make them unhappen any more than we can use a flood of light to put out a fire or Psalm 23 to find our way home in the dark. All we can do is draw close to God and to each other as best we can, the way those stunned New Yorkers did, and to hope that although God may well be useless when all hell breaks loose, there is nothing that happens, not even hell, where God is not present with us and for us. If we rely on God to be our hero, then we will see God as useless. For in the midst of the struggles, in the midst of the valleys of our lives, God is not the hero to come to save and to let us go on our way. But God is the shepherd to whom we can cling to whom we know we are not alone in the midst of that struggle. For we know that God is with us. D365.org is an internet-based internet-based devotion that is sponsored by our denomination and some other Reformed denominations as well. And earlier this week, author Sarah Carver wrote about what this shepherding of God means in the midst of the struggles and in the brokenness of our way. She writes, "What is most important for us to know is that we aren't left in the valley. We are moved through it. We don't need to let fear overtake us because God goes with us into those spaces. God is with us with rod and staff to guide us to the other side. Eventually, the sun will shine on you again. God, as the superhero, does not remove us from that valley, but God, as our shepherd, walks with us through that valley. And then God continues to be with us when we get through the valley and the sun shines on us again. It is not always the thing that we want for God to walk through with us, rather than to just deliver us from that evil. In the moment, it may not be what we want, but in the longevity of our life, it is what we need. A God who does not only save us in the midst of trouble, but a God who is with us. A God who understands that struggle. A God who not only dies on the cross, saves us from our sins, and then disappears into heaven for us to never see again, but a God who continues to be with us. A God who in Jesus Christ came back and visited us after the resurrection, and then continues to be with us through the Holy Spirit until we are in God's presence, until we are in that kingdom all together, until all of God's sheep have been brought and united together as one. Our shepherd journeys with us and doesn't just save us and leave us alone. And many of us have experiences like that in our past, where in the times of those valleys and the times of the struggles, we just know that we're not alone. Maybe we have that feeling, that sense that someone else is with us. Or maybe it's after we get through that valley when the sun is shining on us, when everything is enlightened, that we can look back and see, okay, it felt like God was absent, but there's actually signs there that show that God is present with us. And it's in those times that we learn to hear God's voice, to hear the voice of our shepherd calling us. It is in those times that we gain the trust and the faith that even as we will continue to go through valleys, as we continue to struggle in our lives in the future, that we will not be alone. That we do not have a hero, but we have a savior. We have a shepherd who suffers with us, who struggles with us, who will even carry us when we are tired and cannot do it on our own. But a shepherd who is with us in the midst of that darkness until we see the light again, until we are able to celebrate and joy. Our God is our parent who sits with us and cries with us, who hugs us and comforts us until we're able to laugh and be joyful again. Our God is the one with us always. As Jesus says to the Jewish leaders who are questioning his messiahship, he says, I'm going to read it so I don't get it wrong. If I don't lose it. Here it is. He says, "My sheep hear my voice and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they will never perish. No one
will snatch them out of my hand. The psalmist writes, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me down right paths for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and staff, they comfort me." No one can take them from my hands. There is nothing that can separate us from God, because God is our shepherd. Even in the midst of the valleys, God holds tightly to us so that we know that we are not alone. God pursues us. Even when we go astray, even when we are that sheep that is lost, we are not actually lost, because God is always pursuing us, and God will not let anything else take us from our shepherd's hands. For our offertory today, we will sing a song that is maybe new to many of us. But the song will open with these words, and I think they are on the screen. I'm jumping around, I'm sorry. The song is titled "You Never Let Go" by Matt Redman, and together we will sing these words. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even in the cot, in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. As we listen or sing that song later, we will be proclaiming together what we have in Jesus. We have a shepherd who in the midst of the valleys will never let go. In the midst of the highs and the lows, is always present with us. We have a shepherd. It may be more attractive to have a hero. It may be more desirable in the midst of our valleys to have someone who will just lift us up out of that valley so we can continue on our way in the midst of the light. But God is not our hero. God is our shepherd. Our shepherd who wanted to be with us so much that came down and died on the cross for us, to suffer the ultimate death for us, that we would know that even in death we are not alone. And out of that death will come life. Life that is lived with our shepherd, with God. And that is a narrative that is worth more than $2.25 billion. That is a narrative that is priceless. For in this narrative, God is our ever-present, ever-loving, ever-holding on to us shepherd. And we will journey with our shepherd for the rest of our existence. And may all God's children say together, amen. And now let us proclaim what we believe together as we find it in Romans 8. I invite you to stand as we profess what we believe. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not be with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus, who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. And as we journey with our shepherd, who is always with us, let us turn to our shepherd in prayer, praying for ourselves and the world. Let's pray. Gracious God, even in the midst of the struggles of our lives, you are with us. Lord, sometimes we desire a hero to save us, and yet what we have received is so much more. We receive a shepherd who never leaves us, who journeys with us always, who guides us, who cares for us, who loves us, and helps us through the struggles of life. Gracious God, thank you. Thank you for that promise. Thank you for that hope that comes in you. Thank you for all of the women that we celebrate today, for all the women who have been mother figures in their lives to others, for all of us who have been impacted by a mother figure in some way. We say thank you for the ways that they incarnate your love, for the ways that they show us your presence and care and grace and patience. We thank you for the rain that gives your creation life, for the warmth that brings reprieve from the coldness and the dampness, from the sunlight that gives us hope and joy. Thank you. For all of us here today, for the blessing of a new morning, for your faithfulness that never fails, for your patience with us and forgiveness when we fail. Lord, thank you. Lord, in the midst of all our thankfulness, in the midst of all the blessings you have given us, we know that there are those who struggle as well. And so we lift up Dennis, we lift up Mason's dad, and all those who have been in accidents, all those who are struggling physically, Lord, all those who are recovering, we ask that you would grant them healing and wholeness, that you would grant them your shalom. And be with their families and their caretakers. Comfort them in this time. Grant them rest as well. Lord, we pray for Carol and Diane, for Verna, Willard, Bob, Dorothy, Phyllis, Charlotte, Dorothy, Dennis, William, Jean, Barb. We pray for those who are struggling with addiction. We pray for those who don't know where their next meal is going to be or where they can stay at night. For those who are suffering mentally, emotionally, spiritually, physically. God, for those that we said that we would pray for and yet forget to, and for those who have no one to pray for them, we lift them up to you now, knowing that even in the midst of their struggles and their suffering and their pain, that you are with them. that you are holding them, that nothing will separate them or us from your love. God, we lift all these people up to you. We lift up the countries that are suffering from war and destruction. Grant them peace. Lord, we lift up the families that are torn apart. We ask that you would unite them together again. Lord, for the places where death is more a reality than life, we ask that you would redeem the evil in their place and in the world. Bring good out of it, God. God, where there is no hope, let your light of hope shine. Lord, for all those that have been spoken aloud and all those that have been left unspoken but are in our hearts and minds, we lift them up to you, our shepherd, to hold in your hands and to be cared for in your love. For we entrust all of our concerns to you, O God. Lord, we commend to your care our souls and our bodies, our minds and our thoughts, our health and our work, our parents, our children, our families, our neighbors and friends, our life and our death. We place them all in your hands this day and always, and we pray as your Son, our Shepherd, taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our faithful shepherd cares for us in good times and in hard times. Let us follow our shepherd's example and care for our fellow sheep as well. With thankful and faithful hearts, let us give our tithes, offerings, and our lives to God.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me.
Who then shall I fear?
God of all power, you called from death our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep. Send us as shepherds to rescue the lost, to heal the injured, and to feed one another with knowledge and understanding. May these gifts be just the beginning of us going where you send us. In your gracious name we pray. Amen. Let us proclaim the joy that we receive in the presence of our God as we sing together. Halla, halla, hallelujah. You may stand if you are able and move as the Spirit moves you.
Go out knowing that we do not have a hero, but we have a shepherd who will never let us go. And as we leave, let us commit our lives to our Lord Jesus Christ. Christ in my beginning, Christ there at my end, Christ be in my journey, Christ everlasting friend, Christ be in my waking, Christ in my repose, Christ when I action, Christ when eyelids close. And as we leave, may the Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face to shine upon us and be gracious unto us. The Lord lift up his countenance unto us and grant us peace. The Lord's name is upon us. We are blessed. And may all God's children say together, Amen. Amen.